going to be the winner?
It is Kiri Hogal.
Is she here? Oh, wow! Congratulations.
We'll give that to you tonight.
Yes, yes.
And I'd like to introduce Cindy Allerman. She is one of our volunteers at Ben Harbor, and she's going to share why she loves volunteering. For LifePlan, thank you.
All right. All right, so we wanted to give you a perspective from a volunteer's point of view, how it is to work at LifePlan, what's cool about it. So, Cindy, how long have you been with LifePlan?
Since February of this year, and I was there, I think, the opening day.
February, that's good. How did you find us?
Found you guys through Facebook.
Okay. So tell us what you like about working or volunteering at LifePlan.
I guess the thing that I love the most is that I get to come to work and share the gospel, the hope of the gospel with these hurting women.
Could you tell us a little bit some of the stories of women that you've been with, or what are some of the things that you've experienced?
Sure. Well, a few of the ladies that have not had good examples for themselves to follow, but they've seen a lot of heartache in their own lives. I've been able to share the hope of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And as we focus on Christ, it seems to give them the answers through the Word, through other volunteers, and the care that we give them. It all points to what Jesus did for us. And does that make sense?
Yeah. Have you seen some stories of change or growth?
Yeah, definitely. There's a lady in particular that when she first came, she said she just wanted to do things for her baby. And as time progressed, and we prayed, because I try to pray the gospel to them when they're there with me. And as we saw opportunities in her life, I could share the gospel more and share her personal testimony. And just recently, in the last month, and she had been there for several months. This month, she's asked me to pray more for her, and now she said she wants to start going to church and find a church. And just today, I met with her, and she's very interested in a book that my pastor Jamie gave me called "Growing in Christ." So there's a progression that I've seen over the last several months.
Now, some people are, they're not comfortable sharing the gospel, or so how have you felt? Were you trained? Were you equipped? I mean, what are some things that has helped you?
It definitely.
Your pastor having good training at the church?
Absolutely. He's been a big encouragement, but honestly, over the years, as I've seen Christ work in my own life, and as I've studied and memorized scripture, God has just laid that right in my heart that there's people out there that need the gospel. And this has caused me to focus more on memory of scripture so that I can be ready with an answer to give hope to someone. So, and then I've looked on my own because of my burden that God's given me. I look on my own to find resources that I can bring along and share with them.
So, if there were some people here that were thinking about volunteering, well, how would you encourage them?
I would say you think that you're going there to serve people and you come away from there so encouraged by what God is doing in people's hearts that have not heard the gospel or have not been exposed to just the normal stability of life that we take for granted every day. And so if there's anybody that would like to pour into someone's life by sharing the gospel and even providing hope through the gospel, I would encourage them. There's just no better opportunity here.
Cindy, thank you. Thank you for your time. Let's give Cindy a
as we celebrate tonight, we want to take a moment to share a little bit about what we do at LifePlan. And as you know, our mission is to spread the gospel by helping people choose life and live a hope-filled life. And we do this in several practical ways, both with our clients and in the community.
So one of the main ways we do this with our clients is through our services. And our services include pregnancy testing, ultrasounds, our Life Matters program, which is an educational program. And we're very excited because we just started a new curriculum program called Bright Course. And it's a streaming course, so we're able to keep that updated, and the clients and the volunteers are just absolutely loving that. So we're keeping up with the times and also educating and walking through life. We also do men's mentoring, financial consulting, which is also a new class, and we're really excited about that. on Fridays, we do a baby and me class, which the moms come in with the babies, and we have a volunteer who works with them, and that's been super successful. We also give away tons of material items, the practical things that they need. And in January, we hope to start our STI testing and treating, just to bring in a new group of people. So
we also carry our mission through education and outreach. We are currently developing our school outreach program. Last year, some of you may have read about it. We had an opportunity to partner with Niles New Tech and go into their school and talk with them about healthy relationships and sexuality from the whole point of view of sexual risk avoidance, which is a way of saying that the absolute best and safest way is to wait until marriage. So we're able to get in there and talk with them about that. And we are further developing that program as well. We also held a seminar at the Niles Library this past year. We went to the library and talked to them about the dangers of pornography, and then we also, along with Hope Community Church in Niles, brought in Protect Young Eyes and talked to parents about the digital culture of kids and how to protect your kids online. Those are some of our outreach events. We also have Christmas at the Center, which was a lot of fun. Maybe you saw on the slideshow back there a picture of Santa and Mrs. Claus. They came in from the North Pole and met with our clients and some other people who came in, and we just had a great time, and part of that was sharing the true meaning of Christmas with our clients, so it's a great time. We also do Baby Palooza clothing giveaways, where we invite the community to come in and we give away free clothes, and that gives us an opportunity to talk to them more and hopefully get some of them as clients. And then we have an outreach event called Life Fest, which we did this past year in Niles in the park, and we just opened it up, the park up, for families to come, and just had a great time. We also do other events in the community to spread awareness about who we are and to share our message with as many people as possible, such as Faith and Family Day in Buchanan, and we do have several trunk and treats coming up that we're going to be at. So if you know of any opportunities that you want LifePlan to be at, come and talk to us. We would love to be out there and share our message and share the gospel in that way.
Of course, we cannot do what we do without our volunteers. So we have right now about 49 regular weekly volunteers, and if you are one of those people, I would love it if you could stand up, because I would love to celebrate you by just recognizing you. So please stand up if you're a weekly volunteer.
And some of you guys aren't prayer warriors that way, but you still pray for us. If you have ever ever, at any time, prayed for LifePlan, would you please stand up? Yes, all right.
Okay, guys, okay. So for all of you who support us financially, whether through a Life Walk, a baby bottle campaign, a monthly donation, or a one-time donation, or if you've ever given a financial donation to LifePlan, please stand.
Stand up. Ever given a financial donation? All right, we're getting there. Awesome. Okay, and if you have ever supported LifePlan by coming to any of our events, the Golf Outing, Pure Run, Life Walk, or the Annual Banquet, please stand up.
Still have a few more coming. On behalf of First Church, we want to welcome you. On behalf of Pastor David Colt, our lead pastor, we're glad to be hosting this in our facility this evening. Isn't this wonderful to have these families coming up to see visually? Next year, what do you say we get a bigger stage? And we have more of an impact. And we know this is just a fraction of what LifePlan has done. So in the scripture, Jesus tells us, you can't see me over there, it's okay, I'm here. In John chapter 10, Jesus tells us that the thief comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy. But on the heels of those words, Jesus says this. He says, I have come that they may have life.
Amen.
And have it abundantly. And what we're celebrating tonight is life. We're celebrating the life that has been given. We're celebrating life that has been saved, life that has been preserved. And we're celebrating the life that is still yet to be experienced by the unborn. As they are there, as they are alive, but they take that first breath, and the life at conception, we're celebrating that. And we know that the enemy comes to try to destroy all of that, but we have an opportunity together to make a difference. And we have an opportunity to stand up together. And you've done this already, you have stood. But Paul says this in Romans. He says, for I am not ashamed of the gospel. For it is the power of God for salvation, to those who believe. And I would just encourage you, in a moment, we're just going to pray. We're going to pray for these who are on the stage. We're going to pray for those who are still in our community, who have not yet experienced LifePlan, who are going through. Imagine what they might be going through even tonight. And LifePlan is there for them. But if you are not ashamed of the gospel, I would ask you right now, as we stand as one body, I don't care what church you are from, but if we are not afraid and not ashamed of the gospel, would you stand with me, united, as we pray for life and the furthering of the gospel? Father, we come tonight, we come as a body of believers. We come from different backgrounds, different situations in our own lives, and we come and we see this visual on the stage of what is possible through a ministry like LifePlan. And while we hope that this is motivating as to why we want to continue to support LifePlan, the true motivating factor, Father, ought to be that we are not ashamed of the gospel. That you came to give us life, to give us life abundantly. When we are reminded of what it is that you came for, and we have the opportunity to play a role in that, God, that ought to be extremely motivating. But Father, we do celebrate what you have done. And we look and we see the little ones. We see the lives, both the young and the older lives that have been impacted by this ministry. And we celebrate that. But we also know that there are many more who need to experience it. So we pray that this, we pray for life. We pray for the furtherance of the gospel. We pray that we would be bold, be through it our actions, through our words, through those coming together as one, that we would stand boldly for you, for who you are, for what you have done for us in our lives, that our entire community would get to know who you are through what we do. Jesus, what you said to us, you said that we are to let our light shine before men, that they would see our good deeds and praise our Father who's in heaven. Father, may our actions and our words, may they align together as one to proclaim and to push the gospel forward and to push back the darkness in the gates of hell. Father, tonight, may this be a reminder, may this be the booster shot as believers, maybe we need to be reminded of what it is that we are called to. And may we press on as we are now in the position, as we are standing, may we press on to further your gospel. We pray this in Jesus' name, and everyone said,
amen.
Amen.
So good to see our family getting bigger. Wow. I think there's about 370 something tonight. That's the most we've ever had. Let's give each other a hand. Wow. Since I've been here, this is the most we've had. I think we're going to need a bigger space next year. I want to ask, how many of you, this is your first time to LifePlan Banquet? Raise your hand. Wow, look at that. Wow, well, thank you for coming. I'm just here a little bit of, I'm gonna give it a little update about where we're at and some ministry impact, and here to give a challenge tonight, all right? So just, all right, so something very quick here. I just wanna give an update about some of the things that have been happening this past year. And let's see what we have here. Okay, you know that a year ago, so over a year now, we had our first name brand that we've ever had, LifePlan. We changed from Pregnancy Care Center to LifePlan, and I want you to know it's been received really well. Do you like it? Like it? Some of you don't even know, but we had this great change. I want you to know that the Christians and the non-Christians have loved this name. And again, I want to highlight the importance of why we changed this name. We changed it to open our doors even wider, to becoming more proactive, and to make a closer connection to the gospel. Why? Because you all know, we all know, God has a life plan for your life. All right. So, okay. So another thing that we've done is some update, not only in the name, but also the Bent Harbor site. We are open at Benton Harbor, if you don't know that, and we are right there 8 minutes away. Yes. 8 minutes away from here. And it's very strategic because right across the street is Lark's barbecue place. And every Friday they have seafood gumbos that's out of this world. I love seafood gumbo. But more strategically, it's very strategic because we can serve Benton Harbor and also St. Joe. And we have people coming and we're starting to grow. In fact, we have 15 out of that 40-something volunteers that are already serving at Benton Harbor. And I want to, Debbie Sobanski, raise your hand. Where's Debbie? Deb is the leader there, so she's already serving. She's a great leader, yes. I will tell you, we are growing. We started in February, and I'll show you this slide, some slides here. Great building. This is our first client there. We have We have ultrasound that we are offering for the people, the community. And take a look at this. This is our growth. Some of our clients, February, March, we have nothing. Then all of a sudden, it started to grow because we had an outreach. Every month, we're inviting community people to come and get to know our place. So it's just by word of mouth. Sooner or later, it'll get grow and grow. And right now, we're open 3 days a week. If you have a church that's interested in helping us open more days a week, that'd be great. And also, interesting enough, we have a growing number of churches starting to volunteer and starting to support us from the Bent Harbor area. All right? So that's Bent Harbor. And the next one is STI testing. This was my goal for this year. My goal was to establish STI testing so that again, the reason is we want more opportunity to speak the gospel into people's lives. Okay, well, interesting enough, we already have our people trained. We have the policy manual, we have the site, but you know, we're waiting until January because of the holidays and the capacity. So it's going to be open January, first week of January. So this is exciting. Again, why are we doing this? Because of the gospel of Jesus Christ, speaking into more people every week, every day, about their choices in life. And we're hoping that there'll be big transformation in the people's lives. Okay, now, so impact, what are we doing? What impact are we making in LifePlan? Well, I want to start with the babies. Everybody loves babies. Okay, we had, as we know, we can figure out, we had about 15 babies that were born to us this year. 15 of them. That's just seven of them. And this is that we know of. There's some because, you know, we lost contact, they had ultrasound, and then we lost contact with them. But I want you to know, this is very special. And the reason why this is very special is because of this. We live in a culture that legalizes abortion. Okay? So anybody can have an abortion if they want. There's no discrimination against it. Also, did you know that 60% of women that already have abortion, they already have kids? So that doesn't stop the abortion. Even though they've had kids already, you'll see in one of our videos, the highlight video later, that testimony. Not only that, but this is such a complex situation. Sometimes we think, because we don't have the experience, it's as easy as, oh, I don't want to get rid of my child. But it's more complicated than that, because I don't know if you know, women who make a decision for abortion, 60% of them determine their decision based on what the father thinks. So if they go home and the father or the partner says, I don't want to have that baby, they can change their mind. And some of these situations are complex. Another one is 40% of women making a decision is based on what the father thinks. So just imagine if the woman decides and she goes home or she has a fight with the partner, that very moment, that decision could change even though they come to our place. So we usually pray for them, and not only that, we believe every single client who comes to us is abortion-minded, because the decisions can change. That's why we try to build relationship with them. And by God's grace, babies are born in our community. And this is what your dollars, what your service is giving to. Amen? Amen. Amen. I want to say that another impact that we have is the stats to that right there. This is, we do more than just say babies. We also point people to Jesus. Here's a great story. This is Anna. Anna came to us with just having an ultrasound, just getting an ultrasound. So she got an ultrasound. She was in a complicated, difficult relationship with someone. And through this ultrasound, she built a relationship with our medical people. And they started having meetings on a weekly basis. And then they decided, hey, can we do a Bible study? Because Anna was struggling with this decision. And then so they had a Bible study. Now Anna, what made it complicated is Anna lives about 45 minutes away. So they did their Bible study in the beginning, but all of a sudden, you know, it's too hard to drive there every week. So you know what they did? They had a Bible study on the phone every week. for over a year. And Anna became a Christian. Not only did Anna become a Christian, yes, thank you, Lord, thank you, Lord. Not only did Anna become a Christian, but also we found her a church where she lived. They were there when she gave birth. And it's a great story about who we are. Our mission is not only to help people choose life, but live that fulfilled life in Jesus. We're pointing them to Jesus. This is just one of many stories that each of these volunteers talk to every week and connect with every week, and they point them to Jesus. They give them resources, they give them perspective to better walk with Jesus. This is what LifePlan is all about. We don't only help people choose life, we help them to find Jesus, that hope-filled life. Amen? That's what we're all about. And that's what your money, and that's what your time and your investment is all about. Because I've been around the block. Interesting enough, I've done prison ministry, I've done cross-culture ministry, and then now life ministry. And you know what? There's the same problem. It's a heart problem. It's a gospel problem. And I praise God that we're partnering with churches, because I believe the hope of the world is in the Church of Jesus Christ. It's people like you who come and join our ministry and spread that gospel to the world.
Amen. Okay.
So not only do we, how do we prepare? I mean, if you ask me, how do I prepare people to be ready to present the gospel? I'll tell you, it's very rigorous here. This is some of our training. I don't know if you know, but all our volunteers go to a gospel training. Imagine the different denomination I work with. Just imagine the different denominations I work with. So we got to, what is the gospel? So we get them together, we have a training on what is the gospel. We get them trained on what is evangelism, how do we do evangelism. And the next training we do, how do we do discipleship? How do we help people grow? So I always work with pastors, and I tell pastors, you know what? Bring your people here. You equip them, here's an opportunity they can serve and be in the front line talking to people about Jesus Christ. And not only do we provide training, but this is the heart of our ministry. These are my core values, because you know, I've been in ministry for a while, and I see that not only strategies, but you gotta build a culture. And the culture that we built is right here, right there. It's the gospel, it's integrity, it's leadership development, it's working as a team, and always improving. We can always improve. This week, we're gonna be looking at this banquet. How can we improve? How can we make it better? And of course, we're all about customer service. But I want you to see the heart there. We're all about the gospel of Jesus Christ. How are we impacting the community? Lisa and Sherry has sent in here some pictures of those training. Since we started, look at that spike of all the trainings that we've done since the beginning. This year, we had 14 training. This year, we're already up to 39 training. So I want you to see that. I want you to see that LifePlan is not only about clients coming in, but we're going out into the community now. We're doing a pornography seminar. As Peter said, the root problem in this abortion thing is sexual immorality. It's the pornography that we have in our world today. This is a great training that we've offered in our community. We're going to continue. We're partnering with them. Protecting young eyes. It's helping parents and grandparents protect their children with the pornography, with social media. Not only that, we're also into schools, as Sherry has mentioned, and this is one of those big projects that we're trying to get into this coming year. We want to get into schools to provide abstinence, and eventually through that relationship and abstinence, kids can find us and can come to us and say, I have some problems. We can offer counseling with them, and not only that, we can help them make better choices with their relationships. We bring churches together. This is a prayer meeting that we've had in the Dallas area. Every January, we have a gathering of all the churches there to have a prayer meeting for life and the purpose and the gospel. And then, obviously, one of the things that we're doing to just change our perspective, and that is to go out into the community. This is LifePlan. We had 550 people from the Niles community come to this event. They heard the gospel. They knew about LifePlan. It's a way to expose our ministry to them. And we had a great time too. So So this is some of the things. You're seeing here the change. Not only waiting for them to come, providing that service, but going out into community. To take the gospel out into community by providing the service. A lot of other things. I just want to show you all the graphs that the Lord is blessing us with, our events, with our banquets, with our golf outings. The Lord is really blessing that. And as a challenge, I just want to, hey, Peter, can I get that envelope? I forgot to bring one envelope. The other one. Yes, that one. Thank you. Okay, as a challenge, infanticide, I'm sure you know about it. It was a Roman practice early in the Roman Empire. And it was, if you didn't want your baby, what you do is just, you leave it out for to be exposed. Some people didn't want their baby because they didn't like the gender, or it was deformed. So they left them out in the garbage dump. Ephesus, there was a garbage dump in Ephesus. They left babies there. And this was a practice that was acceptable, that was legal in the early Roman Empire. And you know as well as I do, we have our own infanticide today, and it's called abortion. Do you know what the Christian people did in the early church in Acts? They picked up those babies. They adopted them into their families. They brought them to the church, and they started their own kind of adoption agency where they brought all the babies together and they raised them. The Christians did that. Do you know why the Christians did that? Because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Because of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Because they were changed from the inside, and they believed that every human being was created in the image of God. We have our own infanticide today, and it's called abortion. And we must step in that front line. We must do something about it. And I'm so thankful that all of you are here for that. And there's a lot of you that believe in this. We have to continue this fight. It's a very important. Every single child that comes up here is very important to our Heavenly Father and to all of us. When a society stops valuing children, look out, everybody is a free for all there. And our people. So we need to value our children, and I thank you. And Jonathan is going to come up here later and challenge all of us to give, but there's a special, there's only four of them in each table. If you want to, this is a big ticket items that we as a team brought together. If you're interested in taking this ministry to one step even farther, not just, but some of us have been blessed bountifully, financially, and I just want to say, if you're interested in taking this ministry to the next level, to open up South Bend, we would love to open up South Bend, some of those items, ticket items are in here. I just want to thank you again for all of you who are fighting this fight. God bless you, and thank you for coming tonight. I'm supposed to introduce our speaker for tonight. Her name is Donna Harrison. She's currently serving as an executive director of the American Association of Pro-Life Obstetrician and Gynecologists, the largest non-sectarian pro-life physician organization in the world. They have over 4,000 members across the United States. In her leadership, the nonprofit has grown two times, double. She's married to Mark Harrison, MD, and she's the mother of five children and five grandchildren. Let's welcome Donna Harrison.
Accept the intentional killing of unborn children. Well, bottle of tissue. But thank God with ultrasound, like LifePlan offers, that truth is now known that most people know that there's a baby inside. The fetus is an immature human being. But the second lie that LifePlan is dealing with is this lie about women's empowerment. If he can walk away, I can walk away. And by dealing with the men and strengthening the couple unit and providing resources for the family, LifePlan is actually addressing that walk away. She's not alone, and LifePlan has been beside her. The third lie that abortion rests on is we don't want those kind of people around. And this is why most abortion clinics are located near Hispanic and African American neighborhoods. I don't know how many of you saw the CNN interview with Ruth Bader Ginsburg. I believe it was CNN, it was TV. She was asked about Roe versus Wade because she was a justice on the court at the time. She said, yeah, we thought Roe versus Wade was going to solve the problem of unwanted minorities in this country. What an amazing thing to say. But the truth is every human being is of infinite worth. And the last lie, the lie that my organization tries to address is the lie that abortion is good for women. Abortion is not good for women. Abortion hurts women. The biggest debate we've been involved with recently, how many of you are aware that Facebook shut down live actions videos from Lila Rose? Okay. Lila Rose was quoting our organization. What we have said is, as obstetricians and gynecologists, we can tell you there is no medical reason for elective abortion. But let me explain why we can say that. Abortion is what's up here. I can't show you, but up there in the corner, that is the one of the multiple definitions of abortion. But it's a good standard definition, medical definition of abortion. And it's the termination of a pregnancy after, accompanied by, resulting in, or closely followed by, the death of the embryo or fetus. Well, that involves two things, that errors that come out, the separation of the mother and the fetus, and the death of the fetus. In the separation, that separation can happen spontaneously, or it can be caused by human beings. And of those caused by human beings, sometimes we have to save the life of a mom, and sometimes we have to separate the mom and the baby before that baby can live outside the mom's womb. That is not an abortion. It's actually more properly called a premature parturition, or a pre-viable parturition. In contrast, an elective-induced abortion is done for the express purpose of producing a dead baby. How can I say that? The partial birth abortion hearings before the Supreme Court, the abortionists argued that to ban partial birth abortion was an infringement of trade because the product they are paid to produce is a dead baby, and that's the difference between a delivery and an abortion. So we put out this position statement in conjunction with Catholic Medical Association, CMDA, American College of Pediatricians, and we've said, as experienced practitioners and researchers in obstetrics and gynecology, we affirm that elective abortion, which is defined as procedures done to intentionally end the life of a preborn child, are not medically necessary. Sometimes it is necessary to separate the mother and the preborn child at an age where the child can't survive. The intent of these separation procedures is to save the life of both if we could, but at least save the life of one. In contrast, an elective abortion, where the purpose of the procedure is different, it's to guarantee that the baby is born dead. Well, what is the prevalence of how many abortions are we talking in this country, elective abortions? Before 8 weeks is the blue. So that's about 471,000 human beings. The orange is 8 to 13 weeks. That's about almost 200,000 human beings a year. The gray is 14 to 20 weeks. That's the D&E abortions. That's 50,000 human beings a year. And after 21 weeks, these are babies that could survive, possibly survive outside the womb, 10,000 human beings a year. The good news is that as abortion numbers decline, abortion numbers are declining. At least reported abortion numbers are declining. But you can see at the bottom, chemical abortion with mifepristone and misoprostol, the two-drug regimen, they're actually increasing. Almost half of the abortions up to 10 weeks are drug-induced abortions now, and the number is climbing. And abortion advocates are pushing for all abortions to be started with drugs, including second and third trimester abortions, and then finish in the ER. So what's our challenge? Drug-induced abortion is a big challenge for us. Fortunately, you guys are poised in a position to be able to respond in this community. The bad news is there's 70 plus online sites which sell mifepristone and misoprostol without a doctor's prescription. Abortionists are pushing for drug-induced abortion throughout pregnancy, and the decision point for the abortion will be the woman's heart and mind and not the clinic. Why is that important? You can't protest in front of a woman's heart and mind. You have to be doing the things that LifePlan is doing. You have to be in the schools. You have to be offering chances to interact with that woman and plant the seeds for life. And so LifePlan is doing those things that will meet the challenge of the next decade, which is medication abortion. The good news is abortion pill reversal works. And so if a woman has taken the first drug of the chemical abortion, mifepristone, you can give her natural progesterone, and it'll increase her chances of having a live baby from 25% to about 68%, which is a good increased chance, nothing's 100%. We can get the word out about how horrible drug-induced abortions are in the second and third trimester. I'm going to talk a little bit about that so that you guys are equipped with medical evidence as to why this is a really bad idea for the women that you encounter. And we can involve churches and the media to change women's hearts and minds. And guys, we are winning. We are winning this debate. But what are the risks of elective abortion, whether it's medical or surgical? There are the risks of bleeding, infection, damage to the womb, or the organs around the womb for surgical abortion, anesthetic complications for surgical abortion and death. Long term, there's risks of preterm birth and subsequent pregnancies. Breast cancer and abortion, though it's not all breast cancer and it's not all abortion. We'll talk a little bit about that. And suicide, drug abuse, and major depression. Well, let's look a little bit at the immediate risks. What are the risks of a woman having a massive amount of bleeding? With a medical abortion, it's about 1 out of 6 women. With a surgical abortion, it's about 1 out of 50. The risks of bleeding tissue inside, with a medical abortion, it's about 1 out of 15. And with a surgical abortion, it's about 1 out of 60. The risks of needing an emergency surgery are about 1 in 18 for a medical abortion, and surgical is about 1 out of 55. But I want you to look carefully at this next slide. This is the top is the risk is the incidence of women who have to have surgery to complete a medical abortion. The bottom is how old the woman is. And you can see when you get past about 10 weeks, that the risk of having to have emergency surgery because of mostly bleeding with a medical abortion rises astronomically till you get into the 50 to 60% range, 1 out of 2 women. That's why medical abortion in the second trimester is a really bad idea, but that's where the abortionists are pushing right now. I want to show you this slide as well. This is legal induced abortion. This is death, the rate of death. Women dying immediately from the abortion. And this is from the Center for Disease Control. The bottom lines here are, the bottom line here is the gestational age in weeks, okay? So as the pregnancy progresses, it becomes more and more risky for the woman, an immediate risk of death for a woman who has an abortion 18, 20, 22 weeks. And at 20 weeks, the risk of dying from the abortion crosses the risk of a live birth mortality, that is dying from live birth. So anyone who says to you, oh, abortion's much better than childbirth, they're lying. And especially at the point where the baby can survive outside the womb, it is more dangerous for a woman to have an abortion than it is for her to carry that baby the rest of the way to term. Let's talk about some of the long-term risks. Preterm birth and subsequent pregnancies, breast cancer and abortion, and suicide, drug abuse, and major depression. You see, when a woman walks into the abortion clinic, there's two victims there. One dies, and the other comes out wounded. And the woman comes out wounded. This is the editor of the British Journal of OB-GYN, one of the world-class OB-GYN journals in the world. And he says, talking about abortion and preterm birth, he says a key finding in the study that he's reviewing is that compared to women with no history of termination, that is abortion, even allowing for expected higher socioeconomic disadvantage, women with just one abortion had an increased odds of subsequent preterm birth. This is Dr. Jay Imes, who's the guru in the United States of preterm birth. And he says, contrary to common belief, population-based studies have found that elective terminations in the first and second trimester are associated with very small, it's not very small, but real risk of subsequent preterm birth. Why is this important? Well, it turns out that preterm birth affects 1 out of 12 pregnancies in this country. It's huge. I mean, economic costs are tremendous. So why don't we hear about abortion being a cause of preterm birth? There's an economic reason for that. I don't know how many of you know who this guy is holding the book Healthcare Reform. This is Jonathan Gruber, who's one of the architects of the Affordable Care Act. And this is his little manuscript, his monograph in there, which is the Gruber calculation of savings to the government resulting from abortion. From these results, he says, we estimate that the legalization of abortion saved the federal government over $14 billion in welfare payments through 1994. That's why we have elective abortion in this country. It's one reason we don't want those kind of people around. Now, what we also know is abortion to those people is the gift that keeps on giving. Because these are very preterm infant deaths that happen after the abortion to the woman whose baby died, or wanted baby who died after birth. This is preterm infant deaths attributable to induced abortion over 24 years. Now, if you're just a cold, hard-hearted, money-grubbing kind of person, and all you care about is money, this slide is for you. Because the blue gives you the Gruber benefit, the savings to the federal government of abortion from 1973 through 94. And the red is the hospital cost of abortion-related preterm birth, 1973 through 1994. And the second set is extending that calculation, the Gruber benefit of abortion, through 2014, and the hospital-associated cost of abortion through 2014. We are killing ourselves and our society. And it goes on after the abortion. Well, what about breast cancer abortion? Hasn't that been debunked by the National Academy of Sciences? If you understand the biology of what happens in pregnancy with breasts, you'll understand the association. Because before puberty and after puberty, but before pregnancy, you have growth of breast tissue, but it's very immature breast tissue. It's type 1 and 2 tissue. 99% of breast cancers arise from this immature tissue. The end of the first trimester of pregnancy, you get the breast tenderness, that's a lot of growth of breast tissue, but it's still immature tissue. It takes taking a pregnancy past 20 weeks for the placenta to make the hormones that cause the breast to make milk. And once you have milk-producing tissue in the breast, that tissue is permanently cancer-resistant. That's type 3 and 4 tissue. So you can see early miscarriages, where there isn't much breast tenderness and the woman doesn't even feel pregnant, they involve very little breast stimulation. But at the end of the first trimester, you've got a lot of breast stimulation. And you know what? The breast actually doesn't care what causes the separation before 32 weeks. If you have a separation, if you have a loss of pregnancy and it's your first pregnancy and you've never brought a baby to term, you have a loss of the pregnancy before 32 weeks, your breast is now arrested in a state where the majority of the breast tissue is cancer susceptible. Whether it's automobile accident or infection, but in this country, the most common reason for losing a baby before 32 weeks in the first pregnancy, or pregnancies before term, is abortion. And that's the connection. Suicide, drug abuse, and major depression. I didn't believe this when I first was told about. This is from a study from Finland where the medical record is only. They looked at what kills women of reproductive age, and what they found was that women who abort are at increased risk of suicide. about 6 times increased risk of suicide compared with women who give birth. And I thought, man, I don't know if I believe that until I saw this graph, which is on the bottom, the months after the pregnancy outcome, and on the top, suicides per 100,000 women. And what do you see? You see women kill themselves right after the abortion, and then they kill themselves 7 to 8 to 9 months later. This is exactly what you would expect if there was a real anniversary grief reaction from abortion. And this is just following women for 1 year. The authors of that stake study, that Finnish study, said interview-based studies have consistently shown extraordinarily high levels of suicidal ideation, 30 to 55%, 1 out of 2 women. And reports of suicide attempts, 7 to 30% among women who had had an abortion. This is just in the first year. And in many of these studies, the women interviewed have explicitly described the abortion as the cause of the suicidal impulse. But of course, the American Psychological Association Task Force on Mental Health and Abortion and the two abortion textbooks categorically deny that a woman with no risk factors is at any increased risk of suicide or any adverse mental health outcome. But what you have to know is that these are the risk factors that they list. And we're going to go through some of them. I got 3 slides full of risk factors. Second and third trimester abortion, that's almost 1 out of 10 abortions. Prior mental health problems, 3 to 20% of women. Ambivalent, most teenagers are ambivalent about the pregnancy. Pressure from others, and this is a quote from a paper in the Guttmacher Institute website. This woman said, I was free to decide as long as the pregnancy was terminated. Break your heart. Attachment to the pregnancy. There was a study in Sweden that looked at women in the abortion clinic waiting for the abortion. 40% of them were out of their stomach and talked to the baby. Break your heart. Terminating a pregnancy that's wanted or meaningful. Adolescence, that's 17% of abortions. Perceived need for secrecy. Use of avoidance and denial as coping mechanisms, that's most adolescents. Low perceived ability to cope with the abortion. History of prior abortion, 50% of abortions are repeat. Exposure to anti-abortion picketing. Feelings of stigma. Lack of emotional support and criticism from significant people in their lives, like we talked about earlier, 2 to 50% of women who abort. Non-elective therapeutic abortion for a baby who's not perfect. Belief that the fetus is the same as a 4-year-old human and that abortion is murder. Past or present sexual, physical, or emotional abuse, 12% sexual abuse rate in the United States. Unresolved past losses and perception of abortion as a loss. So how many women do you think that walk through the abortion clinic have a risk factor? It's probably upwards of 90% of women who walk through that door have a risk factor for an adverse mental health outcome. So the American Psychological Association can say with its tongue in its cheek, for women without any risk factors, there's no increased risk. And what about the fathers? I've always been struck by a story in scripture where Jesus was talking about the unjust steward, the one who was about to be fired and so went and gave away all his master's money. And Jesus said, the children of this world are in their generation wiser than the children of light. And I have a quote from a child of this world who is not a Christian, but I think it's an encouraging quote for me. This is Mahatma Gandhi. He said, first, they ignore you. Then they laugh at you. Then they fight you. And then you win. And we will not rest until all human life is seen as a gift to be cherished, until abortion is unthinkable, and until we win. Thank you.
Very scared because we just we just not ready to have another baby. My husband and I, we are studying, and I have to study for my status to, for I can stay here in US. And our life was very challenging with three kids at home, me studying, my husband studying, and it's just too hard for us. Our option is to choose abortion. When this idea of abortion came to our mind, I decided to Google something about abortion, and I found something, and it turns out that it was not about abortion, it was about adoption. But this link referred me to LifePlan. I was not ready for the abortion, but it seemed that it was the only way, and I was crying there. But the thing that I remember is that when I entered this center, I was feeling some kind of peace and confidence, and it was the first time we told this the thing about my pregnancy to someone else. We let share us a statement about God, and she said at that time, God is big, don't put our God too small. And this very short statement has changed all things, because when we went home, back home, we didn't talk to each other, me and my husband. We just thinking about it. These short words, short statement reminded us who is God. Because we're kind of forgetting about it, that God is there. We're just scared of what to do, and we want to solve our problem by ourselves. And we forgot that God was there, and He has a plan for us. We chose to keep the baby and to face whatever happened. My kids were very excited to see him, and he brings joy every day, and he brings us hope for the future. And until now, we don't know what will happen, but we are confident that God will, that has a plan for us.
Lyndon, and yes, he does have that much energy at every meeting, every activity he's at. It's just such an exciting time to be part of this organization. So as Peter mentioned at the very beginning, we are here tonight to ask you, in whatever way that God may be prompting you, to financially support the work that God is doing through LifePlan. I'm amazed at the crowd that has come tonight. Each of us are so different, aren't we? Different backgrounds, different income levels, different stages of life, different professions, different ages. And as Peter mentioned, we all have at least one thing in common, that we're all here tonight. I'd like to add two more things that we have in common to that list. First is that each of us have been given life have been given life. Right now, along with everyone seated at your table, along with everybody in this room, you have a beating heart inside your chest. This miracle in your chest weighs less than 1 pound, and as of 8:14, it's successfully performed almost 85,000 beats today alone. That's about 3 billion in your lifetime. Life is such a gift. Life is so fragile. It's so precious. And I believe there is a reason that the international symbol for love is a heart. You see it all over our material on your tables. It's a heart. Because it could only be a loving God that keeps our hearts beating day after day. The fact that each of us are sitting next to a living, breathing, heart-beating, eternal being is such an act of love by our Creator. We are fearfully and wonderfully made. The importance of a beating heart has never been more important to me than this past summer. I'll share a little bit, a very small window into my life this past summer. July 4th weekend, I was undergoing a medical operation to get rid of some blood clots that I had in my lungs. During that procedure, I suffered a cardiac arrest. My heart literally stopped beating for 10 minutes. Doctors began frantically performing chest compressions on me to try and jumpstart my heart. They were doing everything within their power, utilizing every available resource to get my heart to beat again. And by the miracle of God's grace, my heart did begin to beat again. Yes, a beating heart. But what next? Is that it? So I can live a little bit longer and die ceasing to exist? No, this is not what any of us believe here. That leads us to our next similarity that we have. The first, we all have been given life. The second similarity that we all share is that God has a plan for each of our lives. You have been made in the image of God, and you have been freely offered salvation through Jesus Christ. Not only can we accept salvation, but we can participate in sharing salvation. These are our two fundamental commonalities. That everyone has been given physical life, what a gift. That everyone has been given a plan for their life. Life plan. Two words combined together to form the purpose of everything that we are called to do as believers. It is my great joy to share with you tonight that this is exactly what Life Plan exists to do. It doesn't matter who walks through our front door. We acknowledge that every living, breathing person has been given life and that they are a gift from God. We not only share life, but we share the plan, the rest of the story, the purpose, the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ. It is central. I can tell you this with full confidence. The gospel is central to every program, every new initiative, every board meeting, and every conversation with every client and with every volunteer. You know, this past summer, as doctors were helping me, they did everything within their power and within their available resources to keep my heart beating. And this is my hope and prayer that today, October 22nd, will be the day that each of you, everybody in the room, that each of you will say, yes, God, use my life that you have given me to help another life. Yes, God, use my available resources to keep a beating heart alive. Yes, God, use me to remind people that God has a plan for their life. There are many ways that you can partner with us to help us do this. Are you ready to hear about them? I hope so. On your tables, You've all seen this long blue envelope that Lyndon mentioned earlier, the big ticket items. I'd like you to set that aside for now. If you haven't opened it, don't even open that yet. I'd like you to look at this. There should be one of these on each table, a big kind of fat envelope, blue envelope. Inside of that, you're going to find enough to hand out to your table. You can start doing that now. We have different levels that you can help support us here at LifePlan. You can give one-time gifts. You can give $5 a month if you'd like. But we have gone through as a team. We've gone through as a board. The staff has worked really hard to put these into levels that may be really understandable for you. Like, what if I give $25 a month, what in the world does that do? You got to tell us. I mean, what does that do? If I give 50, what will that do? Or 100? We are telling you right now. It's in here. It's so awesome what you can do. What your money can be used to support in our community. Our community desperately needs this. So I'd like you to look through that. Also in there, you're going to see these little handouts at the top of it. It'll say, what impacted you most tonight? We'd love for you just to fill out all of your information if you'd like on that. You can sign up for newsletters. You can be one of our prayer warrior lists. You heard Sherry talk about that earlier. Be a prayer warrior. Get emails about prayer requests that we have. That's how you sign up for that. But specifically, monthly commitment. It's kind of toward the bottom there. You can sign up right now for a monthly commitment. And we have these, there's so many envelopes, but it's good, right? We have these pink envelopes. You can fold up that monthly commitment. You don't have to put a check in yet if you don't want to. You can literally make a pledge. I want to support this much a month, $5, $10, I want to help on the client level. I want to serve $25 a month to LifePlan. Maybe some of you want to give big and get a big envelope and say, I want to donate $80,000. There may be somebody here who does that. Maybe a few of you. I have no idea what God will do. We need your support so much to continue the work. So you can fold up your commitment level. You don't have to put any money in yet, no checks. Fold that up, make a pledge, put it back in the pink envelope, and then either leave the envelopes on your table, or we'd prefer you put them back in this blue envelope so they're kind of all collected. We'll collect those, and somebody will be in touch with you to follow up about your pledge that you've made tonight. As I close, we have about 10 or 12 minutes left together tonight. I'm just cherishing this time right now because I think of what we could do together, what we've already done together. And for me, I'll just be honest, it's like, okay, I'm going to give up 2 or 3 coffees a month and I'm going to give. I need to give more. I've got to give more. What is it? As we close, I'd like each of you to interlock your hands like this and hold them up, look at them. That's about the size of your heart. I don't know if you knew that. When you interlock your hands, it's about the size of your heart. I often think of one of our young boys interlocking their little hands. I'm like, oh, they have such a tiny heart. But it's beating. Their life has a plan. While your hands are clasped, will you join me in prayer? God, we are so grateful that you've given us breath, that you've given us your salvation to share with a world that desperately needs it. God, thank you for Dr. Harrison and for her message tonight. I pray blessings on her ministry. God, I pray that you would grow it, that it would be a movement like she could never expect in 2020. God, I pray protection over Lyndon and the staff and the volunteers and the board at LifePlan, God. Protect us, God. We want to press on in 2020. Give us the strength that we so desperately need, Father. God, right now, I pray that by your Spirit, you would speak individually to each person. That you would prompt us how we can give financially to help the mission of LifePlan move forward, to help your mission move forward, God. We thank you, God, for this opportunity. We're so grateful. Use us, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So, you can feel free to keep passing those around, looking through that material, filling out your forms. We have some special music. This is my wife's sister. My sister, too, I claim her, Joanna Beasley. She's joined by her husband, Gary. Over there, hey, Gary. Joanna has a heart for people to live a hope-filled life. She's a loving wife, loving mom, professional recording artist who has played all over the world. But most importantly, she is a prayer warrior and a woman who loves God and desires to serve Him every day. As an added fun fact, and one that our three boys love most about their Aunt Joanna, is that they can ask Alexa to play Joanna Beasley, and it does. In fact, she has three different albums out in the foyer, and she has committed tonight that any proceeds, 100% of the proceeds tonight, will go to support LifePlan. These make great stocking stuffers, gifts. All of the money goes to support LifePlan tonight. We're very grateful for that. Thank you, Joanna. Would you join me in welcoming Joanna?
Listening, well, I kind of didn't have a choice here, but I honestly can say this very truthfully. I have never, I've had the privilege, like Jonathan said, of singing all over the world, and it's been a joy each and every time, but I have never, ever been more honored to stand and sing for a group of people. I am extremely passionate about what we're sharing tonight. Thank you, Lyndon. Thank you, LifePlan. Thank you for being here. Thank you, Dr. Harrison. Thank you, Carrie, my husband, and my family. I know this tonight is not about me. That's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is God is moving in my heart, and I know God is moving in so many of your hearts, because there is a war waged on life. And Pastor said it earlier, the enemy comes to steal, kill, and destroy, but God came to bring life and life to the full. And He has ransomed, and He has set apart, and He has given a plan and a purpose to every single life, including ours. And that was proven 2,000 years ago when He sent His Son Jesus to die for us when we weren't even a thought in our parents' minds, but we were a thought in our Creator's mind. In every life, from the moment we conceive it, but from the beginning of time, God thought of and planned, His word said. And like Jonathan said, every life has been given a purpose. And I'm so grateful that tonight I get to use mine to remind people that we have the ability to speak life over our own life. We have the ability to speak life over those that don't have a voice yet, that are unborn, that maybe aren't even conceived yet, but are coming, and God has a future prepared for them. And we, as the image bearers of God, and that's awesome, we're image bearers of God, we get to speak life over those lives right now by proclaiming victory and proclaiming the name of Jesus. And so I want to sing for you a song. It's called Hallelujah. When Jonathan this summer, to put it short, died. When he had the cardiac arrest, my sister, who is an anesthesiologist, we were all at her house celebrating the 4th of July, which Jonathan served our country, and we were up there celebrating with him. He actually has the story of his testimony online. You guys can check that out sometime. It's really awesome. But while we were up there and Jonathan was in the hospital, my sister woke us up and said, Susanna, Jonathan's wife, our other sister, has asked us all to get up and pray. And we sang together, and we prayed together, and we spoke life together. And we see the miracle of Jonathan's life standing in front of You guys, we are the body of Christ. We have the ability to speak life. So will you join me as you just take the time to pray or listen or talk to God about what your purpose is, whatever it is that you're doing this next 2-3 minutes that I see. Take the time to join with Jesus because he is our only hope. He is our only victory. He is the reason we get to speak life together. So thank you for giving me the honor to do that with you tonight.
Thank you. What a great night, amen? What a fantastic night. They say that truth without love is brutality. Love without truth is nothing but a bunch of mushiness. It's a big challenge out there, folks, but we serve a bigger God. He's alive as well. Let's close. Father, we thank you for the privilege that we have had to be here tonight. We thank you for the people of LifePlan and the volunteers and the staff that you have deployed. We thank you, Father, for the love of your Son, Jesus Christ, in our lives. And as we leave here tonight, let us say, as for us and our community, we will not stand idle. We will not stand down. And we will not stand back. But we will stand up. We will step up. And we will stand in the gap. Give us hearts of compassion and love for those who are hurting. And help us to always remember, Lord, that you are the LifePlan. In Jesus' name, and all God's people said. Thanks for coming.